everybody. So I am on my little weekend away by myself, and I've hired a little car, which is amazing to drive, and I've seen some incredible scenery. I've just pulled in at this bay called Prosser Bay, and oh my goodness, it is just beautiful. Look at that white sand. And the scenery that I'm passing is full of sheeps and sheepiness. I'll turn it around so you can see. So pretty, look at that. Yeah, the sun was shining, so I think I'm destined to get burned, even though I have factor 50 on right now, twice. But I just ran out, so I need to get some more. Yeah, so I'm heading up to Wineglass Bay and Bicheno Beach, which apparently someone said it has penguins on it. I have seen so many Tasmanian devils and kangaroos dead on the road. That's no good. I want a live one, please. Yeah, we'll see. I wonder what's out there. I think that might be, I have actually no clue, but it might be Maria Island. I must have a look and see on the map, because I think I'm around that area now. So, yeah, come see. Well, boys and girls, I am, as we speak, walking up the trail. I can't pronounce the name of the place. Frecinet. I don't know. I'll put it down below if I remember. I probably won't. If I see a sign, I'll show you. But this is the hike to the Wineglass Bay lookout, which is probably one of the most photographed sites in Tasmania. So I'm doing my bit for the tourists. So it's a beautiful day. We were wondering if it was going to rain, but there is only a few little lovely clouds over there, and it's a beautiful sunny day, and it's gorgeous. So I'm going to chance it. They say it's about an hour and a half walk to the lookout, like there and back, and then another hour onto that if I want to go down to the bay. I'll see how my knee's holding up. My knee's a bit funny today, but it is beautiful. And I'll show you what I'm looking at right now. Let's look. Glorious. I was driving up and I just desperately wanted to stop at every single beach I could find. But no, I had to get here. Look at that outcrop. So I think we're going in between the two there. How exciting. Costs about $24 to get into the park, just for parking and just to be allowed in, because they do a lot of maintenance and wildlife care. And I don't mind paying for natural things because we need them in our lives. So I literally just 5 seconds ago, before I started filming, finished A Shepherd's Life by James Rebank. Oh my god. Oh, this big, oh, I thought it was a spider. No, it's not, it's just a floating fly. And if you have not listened to that book, it's read by this guy, I think it was Philip Dick, and he has the most amazing, like, sort of almost Liverpudlian northern accent. And it's just gorgeous. I'm really sad it's not there anymore. Okay, some tourists. Oh yes, that's mighty fine. Do nicely. Just overtaken a crowd of tourists, but that's okay, I'm a tourist too. Look at that sea! So that's not Wineglass Bay. Wineglass Bay is that way. So it's basically a peninsula that I'm cutting the neck of. And I'm excited. Are you excited? I'm excited.
seriously, guys, guys, look.
Hey peeps, so I'm not far away from the car park now. It started to rain a couple of seconds ago, but it's kind of moved off now. I can actually see it in the distance. I found this little tiny seat. Sorry, the tree is banging me and there's flies. I don't tend to stop that often on this trail because of the flies. They do tend to, sorry, I'm looking over here. They do tend to come after me. Now, I hope that's not burning. I feel like it's the bag's fault. Because I've put on factor 50 like 3 times. Oh God. Sunshine is my enemy, but it's so pretty. But I just want to show you oh, this stunning view. Oh my God. So, oh gosh, look at that. Can you see that beautiful rain shower over there? That's just being highlighted by, do you know what those are called? Those are called the rays of sunshine. They're called crepuscular rays. What a great word. My dad taught me that. And then I said, Dad, do you remember teaching me how to say that word? And he was like, no, is that what they're called? I was like, oh my God, it's like my formation memory. And he's forgotten. But it's just beautiful. The sun is starting to come out again, but it is a bit cloudy, which is actually really good for my skin. But I just love this view so much. So I'm going to sit over here for a minute or two and have a little knit, I think. The rain stopped for now. I'm gonna knit on my featherweight. Oh, thanks for coming along with me, guys. It's quite nice. So, hello. I just got back to the car from my amazing walk. I think it took it like maybe three hours, maybe. So I was just reading a little bit about the history of why it's called Wineglass Bay. Nobody really knows why it's called Wineglass Bay. There's a couple of theories that it's shaped like a wine glass, that the water is as clear as the glass of a crystal of a wine glass. But also it was a whaling station for a long time. So there's a theory that it was because the water was actually blood red with all the slaughtering of all the whales. And I was like, I don't like that idea. But it's a likely suspect. It was just beautiful. Did you enjoy it? I loved it so much. I feel so much better. I was really worried about my knee, but I think it was okay. I took it really easy and I stopped if I felt any pain, and I was doing it really slowly and deliberately, so I wasn't going to be pushing myself, because pushing yourself is how you get problems with your knees. So I'm going to go and go back to the little town I just passed through and get some Wi-Fi and find out how to get to my next destination, which is my Airbnb in St. Mary's. I don't know exactly where that is, so Google Maps will have to show me, but that's okay. So I'll see you there. everybody. So I am at Bicheno Beach. I feel like Bicheno is kind of rude to say, but apparently, I don't know, that might be how you say it. I think it's French. A lot of places around here, around the coast, were named by a French expedition. So let's call it Bicheno Beach. Sorry, I'm just eating some rice cakes. So I've heard that there are penguins here, and I found one, but it was dead. Every animal I see is dead. So apparently they come out at night, of course, because, you know, they're out, they're busy fishing during the day. They come back to sleep, they come back to do their thing. I did get a little bit burnt, look, just here. I must have missed this patch when I put on the sun cream. Four times. I lied, it was twice. Not enough, obviously. And I've managed to get some amazing slow-mo videos of this incredible blowhole. You see, you might be able to see it go. Oh, I don't know if you saw that. But just in the background there, that's where I was before. And that's where the rain's coming in. So I timed this perfectly, so that's really good. It's supposed to be rain tomorrow. I'll just show you around. Look at this orange lichen. Just look at it. Isn't that the most amazing colour you've ever seen in your life? I think it's lichen. Oh. Beautiful. Mixed with the grey, like, ugh, just give me all of it. And these like purpley grey clouds, blue grey clouds. Oh, so lovely. So I'll just turn you back to me. Hopefully, I have no idea if you could see that or not, but hopefully that'll be alright. Oh, I've got some food and I'm trying to keep the seagulls away from it, and there's one that's after spotting me. So I might have to. Oh, he's done the rounds, he's done the recce, he's gone back for his friends. Oh, excuse my language, sorry. But you know, seagulls are deadly creatures. I'm having the best day. This is the best day. I'm glad you're here to share it with me, actually, because it'd be a bit lonely if there was nobody here to show. So I'm glad you came with me, even though you're not here. But it feels like I'm talking to someone about the place, you know? Is that a bit weird? Sorry. Right, so I better get to the Airbnb. It's still about 40 kilometers up the road, so I better get a wiggle on. Hi guys. Hey, nice to see you. Oh, there's more. Oh, hey. Hey, how are you? Hey, hey. Did you want some of my lunch, did you? Did you? Oh, there's another one over here. Oh. They're a-coming. The horde. The seagull horde. Quarter of a mile away, huh? Huh? Expecting a free lunch, are you? Hmm? Come and get me. No? No? I didn't think so. Well, how brave do you feel? Didn't think so. It's pushing rain in Tasmania. You like my little Scottish accent there? I thought that was really good. Anyway, I'm listening to Knit British and she's listing off all the podcasters and I'm like, me too, me too, me too. I'm so excited. Oh, I'm so excited. Look at this. Look at this sand. It's like, oh, it's so, so fine and white. Oh, it's glorious. Oh, I wish it was a better day. Oh, well. Nothing you can do about the weather, just put on better clothes. I love hopping across rocks. Not a fan of sand. Rocks are my friend. But look at the colour of that water. Even when it's pushing rain. Pushing dune.
fabulous. I am actually really glad I got the waterproof phone. Oh, I'm loving this colour of the rock. I wonder what type of rock it is. And this, gosh, inspiration. Anyway, I'm gonna go back to Luton listening to Louise. See you later, guys.
So that's my little car. I'm going to go for a little walk along this beautiful beach. Holy moly, the rain has stopped, hooray, but I'm still wearing my hat and my rain jacket, but I've changed out of my runners. Oh my God, look at this. Oh dear Lord. It's empty, lads. Completely empty. Holy mother of moly. This is crazy. Oh, look at that rock formation over there. Look at that sky. It's so grey and dark. Oh my God. Hopefully that's the shower that's just gone. Because this sky looks clear. I should really become a meteorologist. Any one of my listeners are a meteorologist? Sure, I'll know by that time that you contact me if I've been rained on or not. But look at this. Good Lord, and the sand is so soft. Look at all the little shells. Gosh, it's more inspiration right there. Look at this purple. Look at that little purple dot. Oh. Stunning. Oh, I love these layers as the ocean comes up. Oh, here's a good one coming up. Maybe it might get sucked. It's coming. Oh, I could look at this all day.
Are you seeing this? I just rounded the hill on the car and I literally just had to skid off. I didn't skid. I was driving very sedately and I was able to pull into a nice shoulder very nicely. Mum, if you're watching. And just, oh, look at this beautiful scenery. Look at that beach down there. There is nobody on that beach. There are maybe, I can count them. Three people and a dog are on that beach. Come to Tasmania right now. You hear me? Ridiculous.
This is it. I'm gonna go to the wildlife sanctuary. So this is where people take, there's an awful lot of dead animals on the side of the road and sometimes they still have babies in their pouches. So they take them to places like this, wildlife sanctuaries, which kind of are like zoos, but they are for rehabilitating and releasing a lot of the wild animals that are killed on the roads because of humans and their silly cars. So I'm really excited to see, come see all the things. I'm gonna see a wombat, god damn it, finally. I better see a wombat. If I don't, I will scream on the podcast. I found a Tasmanian devil. Behind the glass. Oh, he's woken up.
Look at you. Hi, friend.
Sorry, I shouldn't be tap glass, should I? Goodbye. Oh, what's happened to his poor skin? I think he's got mange or something. Look at him. Oh. He was having a nice sleep and I interrupted him. Sorry, darling. Look at his little face.
Dude, look at this. Look at this guy. Look at his nose, look at the way he walks. Oh my God.
like porcupines. They do look like hedgehogs. They're not related at all. This is covalent evolution, which just means that it's a very effective technique that's been adapted in all parts of the world. So they're not related at all, but being spiky is a good way to not get eaten.
Huh? Mm. Oh, I hear another one coming.
They can dig like they
can dig incredibly fast and incredibly. Absolutely. So when he feels threatened, what he'll do is they look for a log or the nearest thing to him, they put his head into it and dig, and seriously, within two strokes of that, you'll be so far under the ground that you just cannot get him out, and all we have left is spikes.
Oh,
that's how it works.
Look at his little tongue.
Do
they have
to get insects out?
So he is an anteater.
Yes, he is.
Is it insects?
But what he is related to? Does anybody know what he's related to?
Platypus.
Well done.
Oh, yeah.
They're from a very strange group of animals called exactly the monotremes, which go against every rule in the book. Egg-laying marsupials. So they lay a little egg about the size of a pea. And this egg is hatched inside in a nice warm flap of skin, like a pouch. Mm. The baby that pops out, it's got no fur or spikes on it. Mm. It's called... Come on.
A baby
Eric.
A kidney.
Eric. If it's a boy.
Yeah.
It's called a puggle.
Oh,
we knew that.
No.
I had no idea.
No, it's
I'll
not.
I'll be honest. Oh, so, okay. It's the same. Puggle is the same for our echidnas and our platypuses. And there's only three members of that very strange family. There's the platypus, the short-billed echidna, and if there's a short-billed echidna...
There's a long-billed echidna.
Yes, there is.
What about a medium-billed echidna?
Medium-billed echidna. No, we haven't... Well, there could be, but we haven't discovered them yet. But as I said, these guys, they evolved long before placental mammals, even before marsupials, so they're a very, very old group of animals. In fact, they're very interesting because... They're a missing link. They're the bridge between reptiles and mammals. Mm. And this little baby, as I said, being hatching from an egg, it then develops in that pouch and it suckles off milk like our normal mammals do now. And that milk is produced from a gland that actually secretes it more out of pores than out of teeth, which is really quite unusual. So as we were saying there, they've got incredibly strong claws at the front there. These rotten logs, they absolutely love it. They'll rip them open. They're very, very strong. I've got a friend who was raising an echidna recently and he said it got to the age where he started to push the fridge around. So they are just incredibly strong creatures. And anybody who's ever tried to take one out of the ground, pick it up, will know that it's not easy.
How much do they weigh?
About a kilogram. That's a good question. But some of them are smaller, usually. And they can grow quite big because they can live up to 50 years.
Wow.
So by then we've got a pretty big echidna. So unfortunately what happens over winter is they go into torpor. So this is a state where they're sort of hibernating, but they wake up every week or so to go and do their business out in the bush. And then they go back to sleep for a little while. When they wake up in summer though, they've lost a lot of weight, a lot of condition. Hey. So this fellow just moved down today. He came in recently. And the reason that this happens is because as it warms up, they have to eat a lot of food to put on that weight again. So that means that they're going to end up traveling over long distances and crossing roads. Crossing a road is not so good when your defense is to freeze.
Mm-hmm.
So unfortunately, they're freezing the road. You're going the wrong way. We're over here. Yeah, so he came in recently. So these guys are actually both rescues that came in off the roads, and this guy came in recently, so he still does have a bit of damage with his nose, so you can hear he's not breathing fully right, so we're hoping a bit of time in here will do him well.
Mm.
He's been inside for a little while we've been keeping a closer eye on him, but he's been making good progress, so we've moved him outside for a while, and once we fatten him up, get him nice and massive so he'll survive next winter, we'll be able to release him back into the wild. Happy days, hey? Good stuff. All right, shall we go and see who's hungry at the devil there?
Yes,
devil world.
He's a little echidna. Look at his little head.
He's a little echidna.
Oh my god, he's so cute.
So there's something wrong with his nose? Is that what they said?
Get
hurt.
And
we follow the book there. It's alright because at least you get provided with chain mail.
Come on. Yeah.
So this is Simba, and he's a good, strong, healthy male for you. And an easy way you can tell that he's a male is by the scars on his bottom there.
Oh.
So those are quite interesting. I'll explain what they are in a little bit, but just take note while he's still here, because he could just rip a piece of this off or bite me in the leg, and I'm definitely going to let go then. Yeah. You hear that? You know how to get it. Oh, dear. Just pay attention for a second.
Yes.
Believe it or not, when he does get through carcass, he has absolutely no problem getting through the bones, the skin and the fur. Absolutely no problem. Simba's actually just moved down here. He's been out on our devil reserve, so he's a little bit more unpredictable than the other one. So I do want to pay a little bit of attention so he doesn't bite me, obviously. Believe it or not, he can't really see me right now. He's got terrible eyesight. His eyesight only ranges about a meter to a meter and a half in front of his face. So absolutely terrible. So they rely very much on their other senses. Their sense of smell, absolutely incredible. They can smell a carcass from 2 to 3 kilometers away.
Wow.
They can also smell, although they can't see anybody here, they can't tell what color hair you have, what color eyes you have, what color, let's say what color nose you have. But he can tell how many individuals are here. You can smell each individual and whether you're a male or female.
God.
He wins.
Yeah.
Great. Well, we'll go and find some more devils for you then.
Oh, that'd be good.
But he can actually tell each individual here, whether you're male or female, and roughly the age of each person,
what?
Just by the pheromones that we produce. And he's going to use that info to figure out whether we're an animal worth hunting or not.
Or a threat.
Or a threat is also, well done, yeah. Exactly right. But primarily he's going to try and figure out whether it's any use getting up to try and catch us. In our case, that's a no. We're too hard, too tall and lanky, and too, exactly like you say, we're too scary. Our devils, again, are quite timid because they've always been second after the thylacine, after the Tasmanian tiger. But nobody's told them that they're not around anymore. So they're still a very timid creature by nature. But even though 80% of their diet is scavenged, live prey can often be things like possums, or even sometimes they're ducks that land in the corners of the enclosures. Some of them don't always get out because their devils can run about 25 kilometers an hour, ambush their prey, and then sink their teeth in. And the more that the prey struggles to get away, of course, just like a snare, the further and further the teeth sink in, and eventually it just becomes impossible for the prey to get away. So you definitely don't want them to get you. We see who else is about. Here's cameras. Children. You will not get it back. That is for sure. You won't lose it. I can tell you exactly where it'll go. What do you reckon, Maverick? No. Here's a nice
piece of
fur
behind you.
Bit of skin, bit of fur on this one. Hey. Yum, and he's going to probably eat this here because he's got a girlfriend and he does not want her to know that he's getting fed. Yum, yum. Well done. So, a lot of people ask us where the devil got its name. And it was originally coined by a fellow called Thomas Harris. And he was one of the early settlers here in Tasmania. Now, he came down to this beautiful island and he said, look at these beautiful trees, beautiful landscape, all this amazing, amazing place. I think I'll stay here for a little while. Put up his tent, had his dinner, but he was a bit messy, so he left all of his food scraps out, a few bacon rinds or something like that. In the middle of the night, he hears this horrible screeching going, and he thought, what on earth is that? He'd never heard of this animal, he'd never seen one before. So he opened up the side of his tent and he has a little look out, and he sees bright red ears, big white teeth, and that blood-curdling screech, he thinks, this has got to be the devil of Tasmania. So the name sort of stuck, and even their scientific name is Sarcophilus harrisi, which means Harris's flesh lover.
Yeah.
Mm.
don't know which one I like better.
Endearing. So they've had a few other names. One of my favourites, I think, is probably Hell's Puppies. I think you probably still call them that. But the Tasmanian Aboriginals call them Taraba. Says camera is yum. Tasmanian Aboriginals called them Taraba, which means nasty one. And their story was that Taraba used to be a beautiful, well-proportioned, panther-like creature. And it was well trusted within the community. But every day the tribe had to go out and look for food, but somebody had to look after the kids. And they'd take it in turns. Eventually though, it was Taraba's turn. Taraba got hungry during the day though while the tribe were out. And when the tribe got back, they noticed a few of the children had gone missing. So Taraba was banished from the town and cursed with a squat little body, big red ears, and an insatiable appetite. Which probably holds true to this day, I'd say. Very hungry, aren't you, Maverick? Now, as I mentioned earlier, these guys are here to breed. Unfortunately, we've lost a huge number of devils in the last 25 years, mostly to a disease called devil facial tumor disease. You might have read a little bit about it inside or heard of it before. And how it affects the devils is during their interactions while they fight for food. If a devil who has it bites the next devil who hasn't got it, it'll get in through that bite. So it's most unusual because it is one of only three contagious cancers that have been discovered in the world. So once it gets into one of those cuts, it'll quickly inflate into big tumors all around their face, eventually growing so big that our devils can't eat or drink anymore. So they usually die from starvation rather than the actual disease after only about half a year. So unfortunately, there's no cure for the disease. And as I said, we've already lost about 80 to 90% of the wild population. And another 80 to 90% are estimated to actually have it at the moment. So that leaves us with less than 5% of the healthy population we had only 25 years ago. That is one of the most dramatic declines of any animal I can think of. So if we're not really careful, losing the Tasmanian devil, it's a reality. And very soon, if we're not very, very careful, and explain why. If there's no cure, how the heck do we think we're going to save the Tassie devil? It's such an important animal for Tassie, we just can't really afford to lose them. I mean, firstly, they're the iconic animal here. They're the fauna emblem. Hundreds, if not thousands, of people come to Tassie every year just to meet them. Whoop.
Okay. Keep them there.
All right, you can just have my hand now. Yes. I'm afraid there's no more now, Maverick. That's it.
Maverick, over here. I got one for you. Here, come on.
Oh, yeah,
come on.
I'll probably try not to tease him. Yeah. Thank you. Sorry, Maverick.
He's a bit of a jumper.
All done.
Yeah.
You're finished. But as I was saying, they really are an important animal for Tassie, not just as our icon anymore, but also now as our apex predator. So it's their role to take out weak, sick, and injured animals from the ecosystem. So without them here, we're going to lose that vital role. And I suppose Tasmania's ecosystem will sort of start to fall apart. So we need to pay a bit more attention to what's going on. Now, the good news is that just over a year ago, a group of scientists in Hobart came up with a potential vaccine against the disease.
Wow.
So it means that we need to give it a trial, don't we?
There's another one behind you. There was, you saw it in there earlier.
That's all right, these chaps were mates. But we put this vaccine on trial, and we used 10 of our devils actually. On the other side of the lagoon there, we've got a 40-acre reserve, which is great. It gives us a semi-wild population to work with. But we used another 10 from another park. So we gave them the vaccine and we released them in the Rantipu National Park in the north of Tassie. And as I said, that was just over a year ago. And so far, none of the devils have caught the disease.
Wow, that's brilliant.
Yay!
So that's really great news. So we put out another trial, and there's been a few releases where we've been releasing vaccinated devils into the wild to hopefully get a good healthy population out. We've also discovered that a few of the wild devils have begun to develop a resistant gene to the disease naturally. So it's almost becoming a little bit more complicated than we initially had thought. But within the first 2 weeks of the trial, four of the devils have been killed.
Oh, by what?
Have a guess. Come on.
Cars?
Yes, damn, why was that so easy? Unfortunately, Tassie has got one of the worst roadkill rates in the world. It's a real big problem, and I mean, we are known as the roadkill capital, which is such a shame because we've got so many amazing animals here, such an amazing ecosystem. Animals that are just found nowhere else in the world.
together.
Oh. Hello. How are you? I'm kind of afraid of being pecked to death. Well, friend. Look at your toenails! Look at your legs are! A 12-year-old child. Are you afraid he's gonna go for me? You're not though, are you? I don't know if I can feed you the food that I bought. I'm not certain. I didn't think so. He shook his head. You're on a strict diet. You celiac? Yeah, probably. Birds are scaring him. Look at these things. You are so glam. Look, this one's got like a little quiff. Okay. I'm just trying to gauge how far his neck can reach through the very wide chicken wire. Yeah, he's lost interest, I think. And the ostrich one has 2 feet. I wonder how they become friends. How do they talk to each other? Oh, that's a stone. It's probably still a stone. That's why there's such large chickens. I don't think it has very good neck control, do you? It's very like, there's a lot of momentum involved. It's just the most ridiculous thing. Sorry, was that birdist? Probably. Crack myself up. I found a wombat. I found a wombat. He's asleep though. Oh my goodness. He's so cute. Hello, wombat friend. How are you today? Are you sleepy?
About 15 years in the wild, about 20 years in captivity. Yeah.
You know, by looking on the side of the highway.
That they live that long? Or yeah.
There's a lot that.
Yeah, there are a lot. That's why we have them here. All of our wombats here are all orphans. Someone's pulled over and took the pouch of a roadkill wombat and found them inside. So, if you don't think it's too gross and you have some gloves in your glove box. Then you can do the same and check the pouches. And if you do find a Joey inside, you can get in touch with Parks and Wildlife or with us here.
He's so cute.
Yeah, she's in a puppy dog phase at the moment because she's still a baby. She would still be with her mum. And so she's sort of in a puppy dog stage. But she doesn't stay like this forever. So when she reaches about 18 to 24 months old, they reach a teenage stage. And they get a bit of an attitude.
No, really?
Yeah, so they hiss, spit, huff, puff, and they bite.
Spit, huff, puff, and bite.
Yeah, pretty feisty. They chase us around. We're not sure if they're wanting cuddles or wanting to bite us. She play bites, but she's all right now. But she's getting into that teenage stage soon enough. In the wild, their mum puts up with that attitude for about 1 week. And then after that, they're on their own.
1 week.
Yeah.
See, Jordan, you're lucky. Your mum puts up with it still.
we put up with it for a lot longer. We keep them for about 3 years just to make sure they'd be able to survive the wild. But looking at her like this, you probably wonder how she can possibly survive the wild when she's like a puppy dog. But she naturally goes through that teenage stage. But also, we put them into larger and larger enclosures and disassociate them with humans. Pretty much just feed them and run away. So they come out of their burrows at night and there's food there ready for them. They're like, ooh. They are nocturnal and they're very sleepy.
Mm-hmm.
She's funny. She needs a hammock, this one. If I go like this, she just spreads out She loves it. There we are. I think she likes to look at people upside down. She's so sweet.
Can you bring them over here? I can touch them.
Yeah, in a moment. Oh, yeah. Everyone can have a pat in a moment. Oh, Maisie, you're so sleepy. So I can show you some features. And whilst I have her in her bottle feeding position, she doesn't have the bottle anymore. She's weaned well and truly. On her hind foot, you can see she has a little digit without a nail. And that's a thumb. Anyone want to have a guess what that's for? It has a very cute reason.
Oh.
It's to suck on when they're babies.
No.
Yeah, so it's like their little pacifier. Hope it doesn't rain on us. Starting to sprinkle. Yeah, so it can get a bit red and raw and sore. So we give them a bottle teat on the end of their pouch to suck on instead. Aww. But yeah, very cute purpose. She could easily do it still. She can reach her mouth.
Aww.
See?
Oh, yeah.
Showing off there. Also, because wombats dig burrows, they're 2 to 3 meters deep.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and so they don't really need a tail. A tail would get in the way, but they still have a tail. Probably wondering how, where. It's tiny, little tiny tail. I'll show you what a wombat tail looks like.
There it is.
There it is there. Oh. Little tiny weeny little tail.
Oh, it's so cute.
It's really tiny. Yeah, so anything longer than that would just get in the way. We don't keep them forever. We release them because we get about 4 or 5 handed in a year. So we get quite a lot. And Tasmania's roadkill capital of the world. We get a lot of wombats that are roadkill.
Wow.
Really unfortunate. But at the moment, a lot of them have joeys in the pouch. So please, if you don't think it's too gross, please check the pouches of roadkill wombats. The joeys can actually survive for up to 4 days in the pouch after their mum's been killed before they die of dehydration.
Wow.
So do you think she looks like another native Australian animal?
She looks like a koala.
Koala, exactly.
Oh, yeah.
So koalas are their closest relative. But there are no koalas in Tassie. They didn't make it across before the land split, but the wombats did. And they have a few similarities with the koalas, apart from their facial structure. She looks so much like a koala now when she does that. These guys, they sleep a lot. They sleep about 18 hours a day. Koalas sleep about 20 to 22 hours a day. So they do sleep a lot. Yeah. And koalas, of course, have a pouch, and so do these guys. So I'll show you her pouch. There's her little pouch in there.
Oh.
Almost looks like a belly button.
Yeah, a hairy belly button.
Yeah. Aww. And then that's called the marsupium, and that's how they get the name marsupial. So, constant temperature in there for their young, but they only have one young at a time because they spend about 2 years raising that young. Such a long time to spend on just one baby. So that's why they only have one.
She's getting heavier.
Yeah, she's getting heavier and heavier every day. Soon I'm not going to be able to pick her up. So, wombats are known to be Tasmanian devil's favourite food.
Oh.
Yeah, it's the largest prey a Tasmanian devil can take down. The adult size of a wombat is about 25 kilos, and they're larger on the mainland and they're smaller in Tasmania because of the climate. So they're average at 25 kilos in Tassie. But they have defence mechanisms. If a devil, dog or cat comes after them and they feel threatened, then they'll run into the nearest burrow head first, because they have multiple burrows, and then they present their backside. They may even lay flat, and they allow the devil, dog or cat to get to about here, and then they smash their backside against the top of the burrow, and it breaks the devil's jaw. They may do it multiple times, bang, bang, bang. And the reason they do that is because they have a cartilage plate in their backside, just here. Same stuff in our nose and our ears. And that's like their armor plate in there. And it's really solid. When I bring her around for a pat, make sure you feel her backside. You have permission to touch her bottom.
Not me? No. Okay.
Well, you're Wrigley, I'll put you down for a minute. So they have another defense mechanism. And that is to stand completely still. If they feel threatened and they're not near a burrow, they just play statue. I've seen one before, like stop mid-walk like this. It was quite funny.
What?
Really funny to see it. Unfortunately, that doesn't do them favours on the roads, though. Most people expect them to continue walking off the road, but they don't. They just stop in the middle of the road and play statue until that threat's gone, but the threat hits them being a car. Bit itchy, Maisie.
Oh.
She doesn't have mange, but mange is a major problem for the common wombat because of the lack of Tasmanian devils and the decline. Then mange is becoming more and more of a problem. Usually mange does usually affect the wombats, but the ones that are compromised get picked off pretty quickly by Tasmanian devils. But because of the decline, there's more wombats with mange and dying from mange instead of being picked off. So it's becoming more and more of a problem for them. So some farmers have actually installed flaps on their fence line. So then the wombat goes through the flap and the flap's medicated. So it covers the wombat to medicate them against the mange. But what mange is a little mite that gets under the skin, makes them really itchy, and makes their skin really crusty. It's very uncomfortable for them. And so then they're spending more time scratching than they are feeding and other important things that they should be doing. And you might see them out during the day as well if they have mange, because they're hungry. And so
this one's healthy?
This one's fine, yeah, she's good. Although she's not 100%. Her first carer actually didn't know what wombats eat, and so they didn't feed her the right thing. These guys, they are 100% herbivorous. They eat grasses, roots, and shrubs. Maisie's first carer fed her chickens eggs, and they don't eat that at all. So her digestive system is still recovering from that. So she had a rough beginning, having her mum killed and then being fed the wrong thing. Her fur wasn't very good, but now it's recovered. But her poo is not the right poo for a wombat. If you've heard the rumour that wombats have cube poo, it is true. It is cube. It looks like a roasted marshmallow, so don't go picking up roasted marshmallows. So the reason for that is because their digestive system is so long and slow. It takes 2 weeks to get from one end to the other. And there's right angle kinks in it, so it folds the poo into a perfect cube, and it's really dry and solid. But it has a purpose. Got a little friend back there. It stays in place, doesn't roll away easily, doesn't wash away, and so it acts like a scent marker. So then adult males, they can tell other adult males, this is my area, stay away. And then females can tell males when they're ready to breed, when they're ready to mate. Yeah. Hey Maisie, you ready for some pets? Alrighty, gonna pick you up here. These guys, they have terrible eyesight, just like Tasmanian devils. Alright, let's go. So when you pat her, please don't pat her in the eyes, ears, nose or mouth. She doesn't like that. But make sure you feel her backside, feel how solid it is.
That makes sense.
Constantly gnaw on things. Because their teeth don't stop growing, just like a rodent. And so they have to keep their teeth down. In the wild, their mum would teach them to gnaw on sticks and twigs. But we're not going to jump in here and gnaw on sticks and twigs to teach her that. So we give her something more enticing in the form of carrot and sweet potato. It has a bit more flavour than a stick. And so they chew on that. And it's very tasty. And then they eventually get the gist. And they gnaw naturally. I can feel that backside. It's really, really solid.
It's solid,
yeah. You don't expect it looking at them.
No.
They look squishy, but they're not squishy at all. They're just really sturdy.
Yeah.
Gentle.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they are.
I've heard they can really trash a car.
Yep.
Can I?
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't want to hit one of these.
No, they're like rocks.
A bit like kangaroos.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, little feet. Cannot get them.
That's so funny.
Sorry, Pears. He's like, oh, I'm done.
She wants to sleep.
Yeah. Look at her tiny little eyes.
So she does dig burrows. And she digs them pretty quickly, and so we fill them in some days, depending how bad they are. And pretty much after we fill them in, we spend 10 minutes or more filling them in. 5 minutes later, it's back the way it was. So she digs it so quickly, it's amazing. She's asleep.
So cute.
She's very sweet.
She is so adorable. Okay, I need to tell you a story about this emu chick. He's only, how old is he? Yeah, no, let's go back here. Oh, I don't know how old he is. But not very old. But the fathers incubate the chicks
her father is mine by chicks. And apparently his father was stupid and clumsy. I don't know if that's the father. Let's say it is. And stood on him when he was doing it, so he's got a limp. So he's allowed out a couple times a day for a little bit of exercise and sunlight, but he needs a lot of warmth and coziness, so he goes back inside under the heat lamp. But unfortunately that means his father would probably not accept him back. But you know, he's alive. That's good. Look how fuzzy he is. Oh my god, he's so fuzzy. He's so tiny compared to him. I mean, he's three times the size of a normal chicken, but you know. Do you want to give him a hug? Look at his fluffy head, oh my god! Sorry, calm down.
They're carnivorous marsupials. And for their size, they've got the second strongest bite force to weight ratio of any mammal. Oh. Just after the devils. So, Natalia's being pretty brave. Nah, Aurora's a sweetheart.
Where are you going, Natalia?
Yeah. Brush your teeth? So Aurora there is one of our senior ladies. She's a bit of a joke. She's a very, very sweet little darling. All of our quads.
Here we go.
Here we go. She's coming up. Oh. There we go. She may have a couple of years behind her, but she can still climb. That's for sure. Our spotted tail quads are great climbers. You might notice that we've got quite a few climbing frames on this side in the tree, whereas on this side for our eastern quails behind you, we've put more rocks in there because they spend more time on the ground in fern gullies and things like that. So our spotted tail quails are a great climber and a great hunter. And they spend mostly at night they'll be hunting, but also a bit of time during the day, which would explain why Aurora's out right now. So they go off, they'll raid nests, they'll get eggs and chicks and things, but they'll also take a, well, into bed. No. Oh, you can't eat food in bed, that's gross.
Yeah. What do you feed them?
So they're getting a little bit of wallaby meat today. We do change it up quite often. Obviously we want to give them some eggs sometimes a bit of chicken meat, because in the wild they'll be eating different birds and also...
Whoa! Oh my goodness!
This is a new young female. She hasn't got a name yet, I don't think, so...
Well, she's feisty, that one. Yeah.
She sure is.
Reminds me of my wife.
She must be good looking.
Yeah.
Oh, look at this.
She's coming right up. So she's a new arrival to the park, and we're very excited. So we're open for ideas if anybody has any nice names for her.
Yep.
So these guys, they are a good predator. They can go for quite big prize, possums and things like that. And they've even been known to take down small wallabies. So because they are such a good hunter, that does mean with the arrival of humans and Western civilization and poultry, that they suddenly have got a bit of a bad name or not so popular anymore. Because if you're a poultry farmer or a chicken farmer, and your chicken shed perhaps isn't very secure and a quail finds its way in there, pretty bad news. Our spotted tail quails are not like the devils. They're not just such general eaters. They won't just eat skin, fur, and bones. They like the really tasty stuff. All the organs, give us the heart, the lungs, So that means that when they do get into a chook shed, they're not just gonna eat one chicken.
They eat all of them.
They'll eat the best bits from quite a few of them. And of course, this has given them a bit of a bad reputation. And one of the biggest contributions to their decline has unfortunately been persecution. So they have been shot quite relentlessly in the past, and that is what their numbers write down. And even though now they're endangered and really not that common, they still get shot when they are seen, as unfortunately they're still considered to be in plague proportions, but that's absolutely not the case at all. These guys are really, really important for us because, and we've sort of lost our thylacine, our Tasmanian tiger. Our devils, unfortunately, are not doing so well. And our wedge-tailed eagles, of course, are declining as well. So it does mean that all of our apex predators now are kind of coming out of the ecosystem where we're losing them. So that means next in line is the spotted-tailed quoll. And at the moment, there's a lot of pressure on them to fill in that roller, to fill those boots. But the problem is that we haven't got that many of them here, but we've got an ever-increasing number of feral cats in Australia. And that's a really big problem for a lot of our wildlife. In Australia at the moment, there's over 16 million feral cats estimated and counting. And it's really, the problem is that it just doesn't take long. It takes about half a year for a cat to reach sexual maturity. So they're ready to have kittens in no time at all. And it doesn't take long. Ruby's crawling through the trees here. So it doesn't take long for one cat to become 100 cats to become 1,000 cats. So a lot of people think that you can't be a wildlife lover and a cat lover, as cats unfortunately will, on average, I said, to kill 2 native animals a night. So already that's over 32 million native animals a night. But I don't think it's true to say you can't be a wildlife lover and a cat lover, because I adore cats. I think they're wonderful creatures. But here in Australia, if you want to own a cat, I think there's a few things that you should consider beforehand, and I'd encourage anybody who has a cat to get it de-sexed. And that just means that you're not going to end up with kittens that you can't look after, or your cat's not going to end up giving them to another cat, a feral cat or anything like that. Another great thing to do, this is an extra step, and I've got one of my mates has built the best cat enclosure. And that's so good because it means that this cat gets to go outside, get a bit of time in the sunshine, get some fresh air, and it keeps all of our wildlife safe. So good. So if you're a bit of an extra keen wildlife legend, consider doing either of those things. So you can see Ruby's up here having a bit of a climb in the tree. And we put these big domes on either side so that they can get as much natural enrichment as possible and be able to live life as much as a wild quail, as I suppose we can in captivity. But Ruby isn't the only one who gets to use this. She's not the queen of the quail house. We do rotate them around so that everybody gets a little bit of a chance to have a climb and a play around in the middle area. The reason we've got her in there at the moment is because we want her to breed. We want some joeys. So this is sort of like
a love nest.
Well, it is a
love nest. Prenatal.
A bit further than that, it's a little bit like the nature world version of the Bachelorette. Because she's in the middle here and we've got all of the males on the outside.
Oh.
And she's going to choose the lucky bachelor, I suppose. You're right, if we choose the wrong one, he'll be very unlucky, because she could potentially kill him.
Well, girl's gotta do what a girl's gotta do.
So how does she choose him?
So how does she choose him? That's a great question. Alright, so when she does finally find the man for her, she'll walk up and down the side and go with him. And that means, hey baby, let's go. So that's how we can put him in there, and we're all good to go. Hopefully we'll get some cute little poor babies. A little bit like those ones there. So absolutely adorable little things. When they are born, and they're absolutely tiny, and mum's got 6 teats in her pouch, but often she'll produce a lot more than just 6. And this is her way of just making sure she's only selecting the fastest and strongest ones that'll get in there and latch onto the teeth and develop into the young joeys. She'll spend most of the time in the pouch for the first couple months, then she'll leave them at home in a den, and she'll continue to feed them from there until they come out hunting with her and find their own territory. So our spotted-tailed quails are found in mainland Australia. The eastern quail, however, used to be found right off the east coast of Australia, but now things like introduction of foxes, even dingoes, and persecution on mainland Australia has isolated them to Tassie. So feel free to come up this way a little bit as well if you want to have a look. And we'll get one of our eastern quails out. And it's just a great example of how important Tasmania is as an ecosystem and as a last stronghold for a lot of these animals. So, and these guys are absolutely adorable though. We'll get one of our handsome males, his name's Orion.
Ooh.
Well, it seems like all of them like you at least.
Yeah, even with meaty hands.
Especially with meaty hands.
They have a bit of a chew. So you can see absolutely gorgeous spots there, but of course not on the tail. So if you do see one while you're out camping around any of our national parks, you'll be very lucky. But do have a look. Try and notice if there's spots on the tail or not, and that'll be the easiest way to tell them apart. These black ones are not actually that common. And only about a fifth of them are, about 20% are born black. And the black ones were initially thought to be baby Tasmanian devils. And if you have a look at a lot of the early naturalist paintings of Tasmanian devils, I've noticed one or two have got black eastern quails at the bottom because they thought they were the babies of the devils. But of course, they never ended up growing up. So they're like, okay, there's something not right there. So it turns out that it's a quail. And then we had 2 separate species, which eventually they discovered was one when they found that just a... randomly, some black ones are born, and it's nothing really to be doing. Oh, back to baby face.
I've had enough of this.
That's enough. Show business is hard, isn't it?
Life's tough.
The more common colour that we get is our fella over here. Who's in here? Ivan? No, Maximus. Yeah. Now, these guys, unfortunately, they've been sort of tied with the same brush as the spotted tail quail, because our spotty's reputation for going and killing chooks, unfortunately, everybody kind of says, oh, quolls do that, but our eastern quolls are also getting shot still because of that. But these guys are primarily insectivores, so most of their food are sort of roaches and moths and things like that. So it's actually quite good to have one of these guys on your farm because they get rid of all those destructive pests. But unfortunately, they have been shot to a point where they are now endangered. And that's one of the biggest problems, is human persecution. So we need to be really, really careful now that we don't lose these guys in Tassie, because it is the last stronghold for these creatures. A very, very important little animal. Another big problem that our quolls get is, of course, being a carnivore here in Tassie, where is most of our meat? On the roads. So much roadkill here means that all of our carnivores get attracted to the roads. And as they're feeding on a carcass, if another car comes along, we'll end up, this does mean, of course, if a car comes, they'll get wiped out as well. So a big problem for us. But if you are driving around and if you have got a bit of extra time, a great thing to do. We really appreciate when people do this. It's absolutely amazing. Keep a set of gloves like this, disposable gloves. You can get them for like $2 or something, like a big packet of 50. Really, really strange place you can keep them. But if you keep them in the glove box, that way when you do come across an animal that has been hit, you can slip them on and quickly take the animal off the road, which firstly means none of our predators get killed while they're feeding on it, and it secondly means if there's a joey inside the pouch, we can call up Parks and Wildlife, find the nearest carer to you, raise that animal, and either get it into the wild if it's one of our wombats, paddy melons, anything like that, or as is the case for Clover over here, she's going to be here now to be part of our breeding program. So we're really very lucky, because unfortunately Mum was hit, and then a second car came and knocked down the other joeys, but one was left, so we've managed to get her in here, hand raise her, and she's doing very well. She's very sweet, so if you'd like to come down and say hello to her, she'll break your heart. Her quolls up there, and hopefully establish a new breeding program, a breeding population up there, which would be quite an interesting idea. Get them get another population up there. Oh, sneaking in.
It's one way to do it, I suppose.
Corey.
What on earth are you doing? The interesting thing there, over there, is we've probably only got one female. She's too big.
You can't get in. What's he doing?
No.
He's trying to feed, is he?
Oh, yeah. So when they actually climb into the pouch, what they'll do is they'll stick their heads in and they'll try to front flip in.
Oh, yeah.
Usually have the tail and the legs and all sorts sticking out after that. The kangaroos are very friendly. Have you met them yet?
No, they were sleeping earlier.
Hello. Big friendly vegetarians. If anybody brought any pellets, you're more than welcome to hand feed them. They just spread. The head is where they don't really like to get scratched. They like a scratch in there.
No.
Huh? What do you think?
So cute. Is he a boxer?
Look.
They do love a little scratch in there.
You like a little tiny little bit?
Yes, and that's actually textbook how to feed the kangaroo.
I read the sign.
You read the sign. Beautiful. The thing is, when you hold your hand up nice and high, they think it's sort of a branch or a bush or something, and it needs to be pulled down to be consumed. So you end up with a kangaroo on your head. But these guys are actually quite unusual. A lot of people ask us if they're wallabies. Here in Tasmania, we've got lots more wallabies than we have kangaroos. In fact, there's only a few spots in Tassie where you will see the kangaroos, like up on the northeast, a few spots around there, but these are eastern grey or forester kangaroos.
Does anyone want some?
Are the second largest species of kangaroo in the entire universe.
Do you want to feed?
Okay, thank you.
After, of course, the big reds, but they are the only ones that we get here in Tassie, and an absolutely textbook marsupial, and that in itself I find a bit of a blowout. Marsupials evolved long before placental mammals like dogs or cats or us. And it's a really effective way of being able to run away from predators or even being able to carry your babies around without having to wait for them, unlike this poor thing over here. But it is really effective. Now, when the kangaroo was born, it's actually about the same size as my fingernail here. And it's got no fur, its eyes are sealed shut, its ears are closed. And in fact, the back limbs haven't even developed yet. She's only pregnant for about 2-3 weeks. And when the baby is born, it has to instinctively know that it has to climb up into the pouch. She'll sit down for a little while, and the little baby will climb up, and she'll sort of pave the way by licking it to get all the fur down. And the little baby will climb up into the pouch, latch onto the teat. The teat will actually swell up so big that it's bigger than the inside of the mouth. like
it locks in.
So it gets stuck there for the first couple of weeks. Like if somebody blew a balloon up in your mouth. Exactly. So they get lodged there for the first couple of weeks. Eventually they start to grow fur. They come off the teat. Oh, they start sticking their head out. They spend a little bit of time out of the pouch, eat a bit of grass. Eventually they spend more and more time out of the pouch. They sort of get to this size and mum has another baby.
Oh, she loves it, that one.
And so mum will actually have a second baby on the go. She'll have one joey that's at foot. And then the process has actually already started again, and she's got a second joey in there. But the teats, there's two teats in there that provide, that produce different types of milk. So one has the nutrients necessary to raise a small baby, and the second has the nutrients for an older baby, or joey. They're most unusual. Now here they're very lucky, of course, because we come down and we give them nice bags of pellets like this. Here we go. And they know that there's always plenty of food. In fact, they can eat as much as they want, never get a big belly.
The goose is a meanie.
The geese are pretty, they're sort of pricks.
Little bug, you scared the baby.
But all of our kangaroos, actually, they store all of their fat in their tails rather than their bellies. It's very lucky. But in the wild, there might not necessarily be enough food for all the joeys that are on the go that the females have got. So what they actually do...
Look at you.
Loves it. But what the mums will do, they can actually feed the joeys enough milk to survive, but not to grow. And they can pause the development of a joey for up to 2 years, so it stays the same size, never grows. So this is
that because they'd be in danger of, like, if there was like a drought or something?
There might, exactly right, yeah. Oh, there might not be enough food for everybody, so they just say, hang on a couple of years.
Oh my God.
Wouldn't that be a good trick?
That's women's rights all right there, right?
That's pretty good. So they've done well, and for anybody who's taking notes, that's called diapause.
So, did you enjoy the trip to the little zoo? So, I'm really happy that I caught up with the tour, actually. Made me feel better about all the animals being in here. I feel a bit stressed sometimes about zoos, but it really feels like they really love the animals and that they're doing the best that they can for it. Fascinating place. I got so much information. I know so much more now. And I got to see Tasmanian devils and wombats and kangaroos. I think they're actually called wallabies. But yeah, so that's awesome. I hope you enjoyed it too. And see you soon. With my jeans. Okay. I'm grounded enough now. I'm grounded and wetted.